Jacob, might be my most excited moment whenever new clubs come out or new wedges.
Yeah.
I'm a guy that has a pitching green in the backyard. I love hitting chip shots. Conference calls, I'm probably hitting a chip shot or something like that. AirPods are in. S159s were so good, and I know you guys were so fired up. So getting new wedges, I'm assuming, brings a little bit of excitement in your world, probably a little stress as well.
Yeah.
You're going to take me through some of the grinds with the S259.
Yeah, for sure. And I think, like I said, being just a savant of enjoying pitching like yourself and just the myriad of different shots that you can, especially like the chipping green in your backyard, try different grinds, try different techniques. It's always really cool when you have new stuff to try and see, like, okay, what's different? How is this hitting the ground differently? How does trajectory change? So with S159, we had a lot of success in kind of establishing some new grind options for players, but just continuing to further refine those with S259, some shaping changes that we'll kind of talk through. Giving players flexibility, more versatility, just through the visual aesthetics of the club. And then just changing the way that the soles hit the ground in some small nuanced ways, just to unlock some different flights for players. What lob wedge do you generally gravitate towards?
I mean, I like 60 degree, I've had the S grind. I think I had an S grind on S159. So, okay. I mean, I think that's probably what I've gone with most of the time.
Sure.
Something relatively standard in terms of the grind, but I'm very interested in seeing what else is available.
Yeah, so the S is a really nice one because it kind of fits a mix of golfers, variety of turf conditions. It's got a tapered sole, but you still have some relief around the trail side and the heel side. So you do have some flexibility with different face orientations. From an overall head shape side of things, one of the biggest things that we did was kind of changing the way that the hosel goes into the head. And having that taper down get a little bit smaller towards the bottom of the hosel, and then the way that the face profile comes off, players feel like when they open it up and they're kind of hitting some of those different shots, that it visually looks like it sits a little bit lower, so they have the confidence to kind of manipulate trajectory up and down.
So a few more windows potentially with this
club.
Yeah,
exactly.
Especially with how much we use the 60 these days.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
It's just, I mean, the 60 has become such a club that's such a weapon around the greens, even for a shot like this. I mean, probably 5 years ago, I'm hitting 50 degree from here.
You know? Exactly.
And now you could lean on a 60 and try to hit a little low skipper.
Yeah. Really good there. And you can kind of hear that grab on that first. So it's like what we want to do with the sole design is get that strike location in the right spot, but still have it move through the ground and give you the sensation that you're looking for.
You could still open this thing up. I mean, you could still, if you wanted to hit this higher, you could open the S grind up and be able to do some different stuff with it.
Yeah,
I mean,
through that trail edge relief, it just allows that lead edge to kind of hug the turf nicely. Really good there. That's going to grab too. That's sweet.
Ooh, nice.
Sweet.
That's what I had in S159, but I know you and I've talked about the T grind potentially being one that goes in my bag now.
Yeah, and I think too, like just kind of understanding the golf courses that you play. Playing in the Northeast, you get a lot of those really tightly mown bent grass areas. That's kind of going to be your predominant up there. Manipulating the face and having the lead edge sit low is a huge asset to you. So the T grind is more aggressive than where we were on S159. Narrowing up that sole even more in the main bounce section. But the biggest difference is you'll see on this trail side, how that section falls really far away, so that as you are opening up that club face, it's gonna allow that lead edge to hug really tightly to the turf to manipulate ball flight up.
Will I feel any difference with a full shot with a 60 with the T grind versus S? Anything different there?
Yeah, so the T is on those longer, more full shots. It's probably going to get in the ground a little bit more.
Okay.
So usually those, they'll launch a little bit higher. So kind of just depending on your preferences, that can be a good thing. Most of the time when I'm working with players on establishing what lob wedge is going to be for them, we're going to focus primarily on these shots inside of about 30 yards. Combination of like what we see with like PGA Tour shot link data, Arcos data, we see it's like 70% of shots with a lob wedge occur within 35 yards of the green.
Makes,
so like, let's make sure it does what we want to around here, and then we'll understand how it performs as we go out.
Kind of hit like the same kind of shot, try to hit it a little lower with some grab.
Yeah, that was sweet.
This thing is nice. I do love the way it sets up. Just simply put, it does just seem like it sits a little lower.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, for somebody like me who, I do feel like I manipulate their face a lot. I mean, I like hitting even something where you're hitting the low kind of, you know, hooking pitch shot, something like that. You know, it just feels a little lower to the ground.
Really nice.
You know, when you're just kind of trying to hit some different type of golf shots.
Yeah, I love that.
Yeah, this is probably what I'll go with.
Yeah.
But I'm open for discussion.
Yeah, for
sure. Let's see what else we got.
Yeah, I think a fun one to try is kind of a new refinement of the I2. So On S159, we had the I2. We've had that for our last couple iterations of wedges. With the S259, we wanted to add the performance of that sole, but in a more standard head shape. So this sole has a really cool feature where it's dished out in the middle, which allows it to sit right. super low on these more square and slightly open face shots. But then we have that back edge bounce that kicks in when we're in those bunkers and we open up the face a lot. We talked about the trail edge relief on that T-grind, very similar on this E that allows you to really open it a lot and have the face or the lead edge sit nice and low.
So a lot of inspiration, you know, from a wedge that was probably the most popular ping wedge of all time.
100%. And it's like, I always tell people that it feels like I learned something new about the I2, like every month. Like you have a conversation with John A or Rob Griffin, who's our company historian. There's so many little nuances because Karsten made so many iterations and versions of the I2, and why did he make this change and what did that produce and what were players looking for? So it's just a really cool kind of to unlock the performance benefits of this grind, but in a standard head shape.
Yeah, I mean, it's really cool. It really sits down like very nice on the ground.
So I personally really like this one because playing in on Bermuda turf in North Carolina, you can get some pretty firm lies, and around the greens being able to generate height can be tough sometimes. So this wedge allows me to bring my strike location higher on the face okay. around the greens to hit it, the softer flights, but then with those fluffier bunkers, it still keeps the depth low through the sand.
Yeah, I mean, it's just like, and it, you can feel it kind of ripping through it as well.
Yeah.
Interesting. I haven't messed around with that before.
Yeah, it's a fun one. Another really cool one that, and we introduced this grind for the first time on S159 is the B grind. This is a really wide flat sole.
So this, what does B stand for?
Bounce.
Okay.
So it was inspired through our Ping Works program. We offered a bounce grind. This has that wide, flatter sole, but it has a really low angle. So you can see it's relatively straight coming off the lead edge. And if you were to compare it to like the T grind, very different in terms of the section, the main bounce section and the widths of it. This one is awesome for kind of firm lies, but if you gravitate more towards chipping with a square face, it's going to sit super low on these square face shots to bring ball contact higher on the face to generate more height. So it works really well for that player that kind of lives more in that square face space.
It's crazy the difference in the shape of the head almost, even just with the way it sits. You know, it really does change the way it looks on the ground.
Yeah, absolutely.
And who would this be for? And in terms of a player, you're saying this would be more of a straight face pitcher of the golf ball
Correct.
Who doesn't try to manipulate it a ton?
Yeah, they go more square face and they work really well in those firm lies. So you can kind of see how that one wants to get down on this turf. But if you were playing like you grew up in West Texas on that super firm, it's a great option for those players because they typically struggle with ball contact being too low on the face.
Okay.
So we can bring impact location up a little bit to help generate some height and softness to the flight.
Yeah, I mean, it's really nice.
Yeah, that was sweet there. Yeah.
So do tour players, do they change grinds a decent amount depending on where they're playing?
That's a really good question. We have some players that, like, I mean, Neil Shipley, for example, I think he travels with like 6 or 7 different lob wedges.
Really?
Because you have some players that are like, I have my technique and I use it, and then I'm going to go on Monday when I'm chipping around the short game area going out on the course, and I'm like, okay, I'm going to leave my technique exactly where it is, and I'm going to find which club responds best for the conditions this week. So he would be like one end of the spectrum. And then you have other players that would just travel with one lob wedge that usually they'll kind of gravitate towards something with really low bounce. And then they just adapt their technique and say, hey, I'm going to hit these shots maybe in this way this week. Like Sahith would be an example of somebody who kind of just lives in a tee grind all the time and just adapts and manipulates. So it's really cool to see the variety of what different players do. And it's just fun to experiment. And it's like, they're both obviously great chippers and pitchers of the golf ball.
They just do it a little different.
Yeah, exactly. So I think it's really cool when players can experiment and try different things. So like for the player like Neil, he's like, hey, I kind of have my general signature of how I ride. It's going to look pretty similar each week. So I'm just going to adapt the tool that I'm using for it versus the opposite of just like, hey, I'm going to manipulate how I move my body and the deliver the golf club to generate the windows that I'm looking for.
Hopefully Neil has status on an airline if he's traveling with 7 lob wedges.
I know.
Seriously. That'll get closer to 75 pounds
exactly.
quickly.
Yeah, so one of the other ones to look at would be the H grind, another new one that we had on S159. Kind of similar in some regards to the T grind and how the sole is shaped. It's got a little bit more width in that midsection. So what that allows it to do, if you were to compare these two side by side, the H grind, usually strike location is going to go a little bit further down into the face. Works well in softer conditions too, just to bring that impact location down. But you still have the flexibility to manipulate the face open and close for some different lies, because you're setting the sole in sections where its material's removed and it falls away into that trail edge relief.
Interesting. Like in Arizona, what's the grind you think people get into the most? Like we're in Arizona right now, it's overseed. What do you feel like the grind that makes the most sense for this grass right now?
Sure. I think right now in overseed, the H is a great option for players. Typically in the summer when it gets a little bit more baked out,
go back to a T,
like the T is going to be really popular. One of the things that I think is super important too is like fitting for bunker conditions, because those shots, you're always hitting the ground or sand before you hit the ball.
Right.
So we can adapt our technique over here for some different ball first, but you and I both know if we go ball first in the bunker, we're saying,
you're making double, you're shaking hands, that's the end of that match.
Yeah, for sure. But yeah, this H is going to work really well for this type of lie in the overseed. It's good there.
Yeah. Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, it's definitely, you can feel a little bit of a difference in the tee, but
yeah,
I love the black finish. Two finishes, right, with the
correct.
With the new edges?
Yeah, we have the Hydro Pearl and then the Midnight. The Midnight, kind of that anti-glare finish. It's really durable, which is cool. Over time, like a lot of times you would have black wedges that would start to wear out, and you can see an impact wear spot. These are super durable. Very similar in terms of performance, too. The last one that I want to have you hit is the W Grind. So this is our kind of most full sole option. I know you actually play this in your sand wedge now.
Yeah, 56 degree, right?
Yeah, and it'll be really cool to introduce you to the one in the 50 or the 52 in that gap wedge.
And that's new, right?
Yeah, that's a new one for S259. Really full sole, as you can see. It's got a lot of angle and width. So that's really going to keep the golf club out of the ground, and it's going to bring that strike location lower on the face, keep that club moving forward through the turf if it starts to hit the ground early.
Interesting. You had this in the 60 before.
Correct.
Just why the introduction into 50 and 52?
Yeah, so one of the things we thought was really important is looking at like your average player that probably plays G irons. It was kind of a big transition to go from a 9-iron or pitching wedge in that set into our specialty wedges. So just having an option that has a little bit more of a full sole can help them control their impact location on the face and generate that low spinny flight that they're looking for from those longer shots.
Yeah, that makes a lot. I mean, I can only imagine the drastic change can almost be jarring for players when they go super thick sole, all of a sudden you've got kind of a skinnier thing. It probably feels like you're playing almost nothing on the ground.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah, so just having that adaptability for players, it's going to be really helpful. So you can hear how that club wants to stay out of the ground. So it just keeps it moving forward through, just because of the width of the sole and the angle that's presented, just keeps it moving forward and keeps it from going too far down.
It's one of the reasons I love it in 56.
Yeah.
Is like you can, it's kind of the idea Marty talked to me about was with the bunkering, but I love when you have a shot like this, maybe, and it's a little softer ground.
Yeah.
You can lean on the confidence of that sole a little bit different in terms of what you're playing in the 60. And I know some guys will play same grind, 56, 60.
Sure.
And I know obviously you can change it up. I personally, in this last iteration of wedges I've got, I've liked changing up the grinds.
Yeah, it's super helpful because I always like to tell people, like, you can adapt the amount of loft that's presented by opening the face, kind of changing your ball position. But what you have on the bottom is what you have on the bottom. Being able to adapt to those different lies, like, having a sole that's a little bit wider, a little bit more bounce, works really well out of the rough too. Cause like that's like, we see ball contact in the rough can tend to drift really high on the face, ball comes out dead. This sole is gonna keep that club moving through, get strike in a better spot, or you get in a really fluffy bunker with heavy sand. You can take that W grind in your 56, open it up to generate the loft and the height that you're looking for, but trust that club's not going to go so deep into the sand that you lose all the ball speed.
Almost like this bunker shot to this flag, right?
Exactly. I mean,
you have 20, 25 yards to cover.
For sure.
You can trust in that. By the way, I told you I got a chipping green, so I can take them all, right?
Yeah, go for
it. Let's go take all of them.
Yeah.
There we go. So new wedges, I'm going to take these to the house.
Yeah. See ya.